Planet Vero Studio is powered by the Nolan Group of RE/MAX Associated Realty. MyNextHomeFinder.com.
Welcome to Treasure Coast Community Health. We have 8 locations to serve you better. Our staff is dedicated to help you and your family. Here's your host, Vicki Soule.
And welcome to Community Conversations. As the intro said, my name is Vicki Soule. I'm the CEO of Treasure Coast Community Health, and we have the pleasure and honor of being able to provide primary medical, dental, behavioral health, and pharmacy services to over 25,000 individuals in our community every year. And we're so happy to be able to do that because we know how very, very, very important health is and how important it is to try to juggle that in addition to everything else that most people have going on, their jobs, their children, going to school, learning new careers, retirement, and all the things that that might bring on board, like new golf lessons. So we're very, very happy that we are able to help you all work that out through our most convenient opportunity. And for the most part, Community Conversations does not focus on your health because we see ourselves as true community partners. But today we're going to have a session completely and exclusively about women's health. So fellas, if you want to get up and stretch, you can. But ladies, I know many of you have invested partners who want to make sure that you keep up with your deadlines, even though you don't necessarily think that you need to go as frequently as the guys do. So with me today, I have Rebecca Hamlin. Becky is a nurse practitioner. Now, the initials have changed. So tell me again, what comes after your name on your coat?
Sure. So I'm Rebecca Hamlin, APRN, or Advanced Practice Registered Nurse. So essentially, that's a registered nurse that's gone on to have advanced training to be able to diagnose and treat various medical conditions in conjunction with an overseeing physician.
And you've been at our 787 site for a couple of years now.
A little over a year, but part of it was at the beginning of COVID, so it seems a little longer now.
Probably, right?
It seems like we're
everyone
old friends now.
Absolutely. But I will attest that, you know, when I have questions or concerns, I have excellent confidence in what Becky says. If she doesn't know, she'll say so. She looks it up, or she'll say, do we want to refer on to a physician that might have a little more experience or expertise in this area? But you answer 98% of everything that I ever hear anybody ask, and you do a wonderful job, get a lot of referrals as well. So today, I would like to kind of pick at your brain in terms of women's health. I know that we receive a lot of inquiries and see a lot on Facebook about the recent retirements of our GYN physicians in town. And I was thinking back to my time in a small town where we did have nurse practitioners, but all the GYNs were always physicians, okay? But 3 out of 4 were males. And I wasn't particularly comfortable with some of the issues that I had as a younger woman in terms of really understanding. So do you find that many women come to you just because of the gender bias?
So a lot of women are more comfortable with having a female provider for more invasive things like pap smears and just talking about women's health issues in general that they might not feel comfortable discussing with their mm-hmm. male primary care provider. So some patients do come see us exclusively for their well woman care. You know, they have a family practice physician or PA or nurse practitioner that mm-hmm. they're happy with, but that either they don't do a lot of women's health or don't, you know, they would just feel more comfortable with a female provider. So we do see, I see a lot of women exclusively for their women's health issues, and that's fine. We're always taking new patients for that.
Okay. Because we are a patient-centered medical home, though, under the federally qualified health standards, don't be surprised. I'm sure you ask a lot for a records release for those other records so that we can attest that they've taken care of like colon cancer screenings or other things that you're not addressing at that time.
True. So even if it is a like women's health visit, like a well woman exam, we're still going to follow up and make sure that our patients are getting all of the other necessary screenings, like ask them about colon cancer screenings, make sure they're up to date on their immunizations, review past lab results or recommend getting some updated labs to screen for things like diabetes and cholesterol. So even though it's a well woman exam, we're not missing any of those other things. So that's one benefit of seeing a family practice provider and having a primary care provider, is that we're looking at all of those other aspects. We're making sure that your blood pressure is controlled, trying to get you to a weight that's healthy for you, whether that be that you need to gain some weight or lose some weight, or just maintaining a weight that you're at currently, you know, making sure you're staying active as far as exercise, whatever that means for the individual patient. You know, the same exercise program is not going to work for everyone. A lot of people have joint issues or other things that they need to work around, and they need someone that's going to listen to what things they have going on, what things limit them. You know, not everybody can go to the gym. Like generally when I'm exercising, it's with a 4-year-old underneath me, like trying to do a plank and there's someone crawling underneath. So I'm sure I'm not the only one that has that issue.
Not at all. And actually it's kind of funny because we had our diabetes educator on recently, and we were talking about increasing activity. And our producer actually for that show said, you know, I can't figure this out because I was working out the gym and then I hurt my shoulder. So I said, well, I'll just walk more. Certainly I can't be hurt that way. And then she ended up with plantar fasciitis, sores on her feet.
And it's dangerous out there.
It really is. So we ended up talking about chair exercises, you know, just to keep the body moving and burn those calories. And, you know, and certainly input of calories is the other part of that equation. It's not just the activity. It's what we put in our mouths these days. So one of the things that I wanted to ask you about is the number of folks that you are seeing that talk to you about colon cancer screening, because that is something that, nobody wants to talk about. But as you're having those confidential conversations about things like breast cancer and pap smears and all of those other preventative measures, how often does that get to come in the conversation initiated by patients?
So patients usually aren't the ones that bring that up, which is another great reason why you want to have a primary care who's looking out for you and making sure you're staying current on everything, even the things that might not jump to the top of your list. But colon cancer screening is definitely in the forefront of all of our providers' minds.
It's preventable.
Yeah. So big things that have changed as far as colon cancer screening, even in the time since I've started working as a nurse practitioner, I've been a nurse practitioner for about 6 years. And since I've started, things have evolved and changed. Mm-hmm. So used to be we started colon cancer screening at age 50 for those at average risk. And I'll explain what that means in a moment. But now we're recommending colon cancer screening based on studies from the U.S. Preventive Task Force and American Cancer Society as early as 45, which is a lot surprising to a lot of people. That's relatively new information, which if you're not seeing a provider on a regular basis, at least yearly, you wouldn't know. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing, is 45 is a lot younger than most people would think of to start thinking about colon cancer screening.
For average risk individuals,
not
those with
now,
family history.
Yes, exactly. So the patients who have a family history of colon cancer, in a parent, a sibling, a grandparent, you know, immediate family history, they may need screened earlier depending on when that family member was diagnosed and various factors. So that's really a personal conversation with your provider. That's one thing. Another thing is if you've had a colonoscopy that showed some precancerous polyps, then your gastroenterologist likely gave you an earlier repeat date rather than your 10 years. 10 years is the best thing that you can be told after your colonoscopy. If they say, okay, great, see you in 10 years, you passed, you did fine. if you have some polyps, though, they'll likely want to see you back sooner, possibly at 5 years, possibly at 3 years. Also, while they're doing colonoscopies, that's where things like ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease are found. So we're not, the gastroenterologists aren't just looking for colon cancer or precancerous polyps. There's other conditions that can be discovered through colonoscopy. The other caveat is if you're having symptoms. So if you've had a major change in your bowel habits, you're having any kind of blood in your stool, which sometimes looks like dark tarry stools, then it's time to get that worked up. It, you know, that's not something that you want to put off. Because with colon cancer, it generally tends to be slow growing, which is why a lot of times we're able to say, okay, we'll recheck you in 10 years. However, we don't tend to get a lot of symptoms with colon cancer until things have progressed. You know, you don't tend to notice like blood in your stool unless you're dealing with a fairly large polyp or a fairly large, you know, cancerous area of tissue. And so I had a physician that I worked with early on, and his father actually passed from colon cancer later in life. But he would always say, well, it's better to take care of things before the horse is out of the barn. Meaning if you have a precancerous polyp, you have it taken out during your colonoscopy, you come back in 3 years, everything looks fine. Great. Mm-hmm. But if you ignore things, you don't get it checked out until you're having bleeding or you're having pain or you're losing weight. Then, you know, sometimes you have a colon cancer that's been growing for a while and it's spread other places. And now you're dealing with a much more serious situation than if we had done early detection.
So I'm going to interrupt you here because the pushback that I get fairly frequently is, one, I don't have any insurance, so I can't have a colonoscopy. And two, what do you want me to do? Okay. You want me to take something home and send it back and tut? So,
that's fair.
So how do you address those comments?
Okay. So nice thing about colon cancer screening, colonoscopy is not the end all be all. That's not our only option. So there's risk benefits to everything. So it's something you need to sit down and talk with your provider about, you know, what your history is, what your concerns are. You know, for some people, they don't want to do a colonoscopy because they don't want to take 2 days off work. You know, they don't, or, you know, even one
day
off work.
Although I can attest, the preps have gotten so much easier.
Yeah. So the prep is one, that's probably the least pleasant aspect of a colonoscopy because you do have to take medication to help clear out your system, which means you're going to want to be very close to a bathroom facility for that entire day. So I tell people really don't plan anything that day. The day of, you will want to have someone drive you. So for some people, that's an issue. You will want to have someone take you because you'll be given a sedative. You're not going to be able to drive yourself home. Generally people feel fine the day after. It's really like a 2 day ordeal, I tell people.
Although they've even shortened that time frame. Some of the preps now you can just start after dinner.
Oh, that's not
well,
correct.
Dinner hour. You're not having dinner, but the dinner hour.
Yeah. So just don't make any plans that
time.
So advantages to that, of course, you catch precancerous lesions. You don't have to do it as often as other types of screenings. Disadvantages, you know, prep is not the most pleasant thing in the world. You know, different providers use different prep formulations. So that'd be something to discuss with your gastroenterologist. And if you have any concerns with it, like I've taken this medication and had this problem, that'd be a conversation you'd have with them. So that is that. It's a very low risk procedure. There's a very, 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 very low chance of like perforation or damage to your tissues. Like less than 1% of 1%. But, you know, there's risks with taking medicine as far as like the sedative and things like that, which they would go over all of that with you before you would even schedule your procedure. They'd go through all that and answer any questions in detail. Other options, though, are we have the testing for blood in the stool, which is another screening option. It is done more frequently. That's a yearly test rather than an every 10-year test like the colonoscopy. There are a couple things you want to avoid to limit your chances of getting a false positive. So I tell people not to eat like a medium rare steak the day before, or stuff with red food dye or beets.
But you can take care of that just like you can, as they advertise for Cologuard, in the privacy of your home.
Yes.
Right?
So we would give, so for the FOBT testing or the testing for blood in the stool, you do two tests on two separate occasions. And we send that home with you. So you could leave the office with that. Do that at your convenience, drop it off at you just like at the front desk of any of the labs, and the ladies will take it to the back and get it processed
and
for you and call you
bag.
With results.
Thank you.
It's nice. We, you know, we see it all. It's whatever.
Yeah.
But it comes in just like a little kit with clear instructions, and actually the medical assistants go through it with you in detail in the office. I would answer any questions that you have, but it's pretty simple. I mean, it's not hard.
That's really a great explanation, and I appreciate you bringing us up to par on that. I think we need to take a short station break, and then when we come back, we'll talk about some of the other more traditionally associated women's health. Okay, thanks. Hi,
Hi, I'm Vicki Soulet, CEO of Treasure Coast Community Health. We are the only federally qualified health center in Indian River County. This means we have incredibly high standards of care and waive Medicare deductibles. We are a nonprofit that serves our community with primary medical, dental, and behavioral care, on-site pharmacies as well. Make TCCH your one-stop medical center. Spring into action with TCCH, offering your COVID-19 vaccines, annual medical and dental appointments, and more at tcchinc.org.
It's been a long year.
It's weighing on everyone.
You are not alone.
Constantly listening to media coverage and scrolling social media can make you more anxious and upset.
Your concerns are valid, and whenever you're ready, we're here for you. We're all in this together.
Let's make this your best year yet.
Please call 772-217-3663 or visit mhcollaborative.org to find the help you deserve. Let's talk about it.
Are you a therapist or a nurse seeking the multi-state compact license? In the state of Florida, these and many other industries require a level 2 live scan background check for clearance to work in your industry. A1A Fingerprints is your certified live scan source from Broward to Brevard. And if you're a medical provider, you need to be registered on the ACA web portal. A1A Fingerprints will help you navigate and comply with the law. Call 772-494-6556 or visit a1afingerprints.com. A1A Fingerprints.
When pretty clean isn't clean enough, call Eco Earth Cleaning Services. Every deep clean passes the owner's inspection, and Eco Earth uses no harmful chemicals. Check out the Google reviews. They sparkle just like your home will, and Eco Earth Cleaning Services doesn't just clean homes. They clean offices, business suites, and even yachts. Eco Earth Cleaning Services won't just move the dust, they remove the dust. Give your company an earth-friendly way of maintaining a clean atmosphere every day. Search Eco Earth Cleaning Services on the web for more info.
And welcome back to Community Conversations. If you're just joining us, this is Vicki Soulet from Treasure Coast Community Health, where we provide primary medical, dental, behavioral health, and pharmaceutical services. And secret between you and me, someday soon, we'll be increasing our vision services as well. So today I have Rebecca Hamlin, nurse practitioner, who's been working with us, it seems like forever, but she reminded me it was just pre-COVID. It seems like a lifetime ago. And Becky is helping us understand a little bit more about women's health. Because during COVID, we all focused on staying at home and having the least contact available. And certainly things like breast exams and pap smears were completely off the radar. And now we're finding that folks want to come back, but, you know, with rule changes, they can't remember, you know, how often should I come? Do I need to come? I've already seen my primary care. Oh, a pap smear? Oh, yes. Well, thank you, Mr. Doctor. Not today. So tell us a little bit about the need for and the availability of having a mammogram done.
So mammograms are another very important cancer screening. So starting at age 40 for women of average risk, again, if there's a family history, especially if there's a family history of like Lynch syndrome or any kind of like BRCA positive cancer history, your risk is a lot higher. And so it'd be a conversation with your provider about when do you actually need to start doing your mammograms. But for people of average risk, starting at age 40, now certainly if you notice a change, you have any kind of breast pain, nipple discharge, lumps, bumps, something feels different to you when you take a shower, when you look in the mirror, you notice something different, please come in, please get it checked out. It's always better to have an exam and it be nothing serious rather than overlook something and miss out on an early detection of a breast cancer. So one service that we have at Treasure Coast Community Health that is amazing for our patients that don't have insurance is we have the Women's Health Fund. And so basically I would order a screening mammogram for my patient that I felt needed it. And then that order would get processed based off of their sliding scale that they have set up with us, which if you're not aware, we accept patients without insurance, and we have a sliding scale that's based on income that makes the cost of visits a lot more affordable for our patients. Some of our patients pay $5 for a visit or 10, you know, really whatever you can pay.
And that's the beauty of federally qualified health centers. We never turn people away that need care. Every once in a while, we have to suggest that someone take their anger management issues someplace else when they're too mean to our staff. But that's a rare, rare occasion. And we are happy to be able to offer that program through the funding of the Johns Island Community Service League. They have been staunch supporters of the idea that every woman should have a timely mammogram and pap smear, regardless of the cost. And so they have been just phenomenal about granting us an amount every year. Unfortunately, it goes pretty quickly. And so they have responded in kind. They have increased the amount. So we stretch almost a full year. But the reality is it really makes it so simple because there's no coupons or anything else involved. After you write the order, one of our staff members contacts Vero Radiology and they make the appointment with the patient, and voila, you get the results back. And if there's additional tests that need to be done, you know the fund also covers those up to the point where we have to do a referral for surgery or other treatment.
This is true. A lot of women worry about, okay, so that's going to help me with my mammogram, but what if my mammogram's abnormal? Then what do I do?
Right.
Well, the good news is the Women's Health Fund does help with diagnostic mammograms. Say there's a little spot that we're concerned about that we need to get some better views of. We can do that through the Women's Health Fund. We can also do ultrasound, which is necessary for some women if they have more dense breast tissue. That's not an uncommon to need some different visualization of that area. If for some reason there is an abnormality that we think, hey, you know, I'm a little concerned about this, I think we should go ahead and get a biopsy, we can cover ultrasound-guided biopsies through the Women's Health Fund as well. So that's pretty amazing.
It's very amazing. And I know that because I see the bill for all of those things, and I think, my goodness, if an individual didn't have insurance, I can easily see how they would go home and worry it to death instead of being able to pay it. So I mean, we want to take that away.
An out-of-pocket mammogram's pretty close to $100 most places, I believe.
And the other things you mentioned are incrementally
more than
a lot more. So.
Yeah.
So I think it's really important, and I'm glad you brought it up, because the reality is an early detection means so much. And the women are the source of so many wonderful things about family life. And it's really, really important. Fellas, this is where you come in to encourage your wife or your girlfriend to make time. We always say, oh, I'd notice if something was wrong. Not always.
We're busy taking care of other people, and sometimes we forget to take care of ourselves. So at least get yourself into your primary once a year. If you don't have a primary, come see myself or any of the providers at TCCH are all very thorough. We're all very focused on preventative healthcare. They're going to ask you the same questions as far as making sure that you're current on all your screenings and immunizations. You know, it starts from the minute that you walk in, we're going to check and see how you're doing with your weight and your blood pressure and your heart rate and make sure there's nothing off there, nothing amiss.
And if there is, you know, the prescriptions are the other thing that, you know, we reduce the pricing on prescriptions, particularly if people don't have insurance. That, again, is a major barrier to having good care. And so it's our job to remove those barriers, and we work together to do that. So I don't want to give that a short shrift because, as you say, you know, blood pressure is taken at every visit, and a lot of folks have not been able to get their or thought they weren't able to get their blood pressure medication. We really need to protect you from strokes and heart attacks and other ugly consequences of that.
So, yes, our pharmacists are really amazing. So I can't tell you how many times I call because I'll have a patient that they're just struggling to make ends meet and they have a list of half a dozen medicines. And so I call the pharmacist at like a TCCH Oslo or a TCCH Fellsmere pharmacy. And now we're about to have one at Gifford. Is Gifford
yes,
open?
Oh, yes. Gifford. Well, we're still working on some of the insurance angles. So it's a soft opening.
But they are also amazing. Just quick shout out to Rashonda and everyone because they do an amazing job. I can call them and say, okay, I've got half a dozen medicines. The patient's paying like $120 right now for all their medicines every month and they can't do it. And we will figure out an equivalent or we will figure out a way to make it more affordable for them. Where I've had patients go to the pharmacy and pick up, you know, half a dozen meds and not spend a dime. Like, because we have meds through direct relief, we have meds through, you know, or we've just figured out a way that their plan will cover it better. I mean, even sometimes when you have insurance, you're still looking at really expensive pocket costs for your prescription medicines. And so, you know, don't pay overpay for your medications. Please work with your provider. Please let us work with the pharmacy team and figure out something that's going to work better for you and your
budget. Becky, you are awesome. I swear you've worked for us for a dozen years. Thank you so much for being with us today and sharing what you know about better health care for women. I really, really appreciate it. And thank you for being part of our listening morning. I hope you have a wonderful day, and we'll be back here next week.